I want you to be winners.
There's a lot of strain put on just by one family member on everyone to be perfect.
Do you think you can win, Little Miss Sunshine?
Our culture is so built on the idea of chasing your dream. This is about what happens when those dreams don't come true and what's left.
The family starts tearing at the seams because of this perfectionism.
Everything he's believed in is not going to save him.
Winners don't give up. So what are we here? Are we winners or are we losers?
Because we're not focused on being your best, we're focused on being the best.
As if that's even an achievable goal.
A real loser is somebody that's so afraid of not winning, they don't even try.
What's gonna heal his family is if they stop being dicks to each other.
Whatever happens, you try to do something on your own.
All we really need is to accept one another for who we are.
We gotta let Olive be Olive.
Support and sustain each other for who we are.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Alan Seawright, a professional filmmaker who needs therapy. I'm joined by my co-host,
Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies, and we have some very special guests.
These are two of my favorite filmmakers. I've been following their careers for a long time. We are joined by Jonathan Dayton and Valerie Faris, the directors of Little Miss Sunshine.
Hello.
Welcome to the show.
Good morning.
Good day.
It's good
whenever, whatever time it is.
Yes. For those of you watching at 2 a.m., go to sleep.
Seriously, so excited to have you on the show. So today we're going to be doing a movie family therapy on the family from Little Miss Sunshine.
Mm-hmm.
And the theme we're going to be exploring is when your dreams are not realized, which happens, like dreams are dropping like flies in this movie.
Happens to pretty much everyone in the film.
It's really sad, and then it's really beautiful, and then it's uplifting and heartwarming while being super crass, and I love the whole combination of it. Let's dive in looking at the family dynamics here.
Giddy up.
Right.
What happened to your arms?
Olive?
That's all right. I had a little accident. I'm okay.
How's the routine coming, honey?
It's good.
Yeah? When you show it to us?
I don't know. It's up to Grandpa.
A couple of days. Still needs work. What's that, chicken? Every night is the chicken. Holy God almighty.
What did he
say? You can get something to eat for dinner around here that's not the goddamn chicken?
Hey, Dad.
I'm just saying.
Dad.
This is for YouTube, so.
Whenever you want to start cooking your own food, you're more than welcome.
Sunset Manor, you know.
Like Sunset Manor so much, you shouldn't have got yourself kicked out of there, right?
God's sakes.
Everyone on this cast is so good, and Alan Arkin just walks away with every scene somehow. It's unbelievable.
Been 9 months, Frank. Man, is that a word? Not one. I think it shows tremendous discipline.
Richard?
I really do. Really, I think we could learn something from Dwayne. Dwayne has a goal. He has a dream. It may not be my dream, may not be yours, but he's pursuing it with great conviction and focus.
He's like, you're so foolish. About the nine
steps and oh, for crying out loud.
About the nine steps and how Dwayne's utilizing at least seven of them in his personal quest to self-fulfillment.
Richard, please.
Well, just saying, come around. Like you could use our support.
I could talk to you guys just about this scene for an hour.
I have to say, I think we love shooting around a kitchen dining room table and in a car. Because I think that's where, you know, some of the best family conversations happen in
cars. Yeah, and it feels very real.
Yeah.
Congratulations, you got your wish on about 70% of this movie. Also, are you masochists?
Yes. I think the key for us in this process was we had a week of rehearsals.
Oh, that's so nice.
Yeah, I know. I mean, with all six of them.
Wow.
So rather than like reading dialogue and rehearsing scenes, we just kind of helped develop them as a family. And it was an incredible experience. I think that's a really key part of it is developing, making those relationships feel real and have a history with each other.
Yeah. So there's tension in this dinner table scene because Richard is so perfection oriented and he's got, is it the nine steps?
He's got the nine step program.
But he himself is failing and doesn't see it. And the thing is, obviously, he buys into like twisted versions of healthy principles. Right? That failure is just a stepping stone to success. That's absolutely true. The issue with Richard is he's so focused on a specific outcome, and in life you cannot guarantee outcomes. But he is thinking, if I follow these nine steps, I will have the exact life that I want. And if I can just get my family on board. And he's talking about how he's come around on Dwayne and he's really supportive of him. It's not my goal, it's not my dream, but look at him, he's chasing it and he's pursuing it. And I love Paul Dano's face. It's like, go to hell, Dad. Like, it's such a great bit of performance. There's a lot of strain put on just by one family member on everyone to be perfect. And they all loathe him for it. And he's living in denial of his own reality. And it's going to bite everyone in the ass. And they need to get to a healthier place.
We talked a lot about this film was exploring our need to win. And so Richard, the father, has this program and it's all about winning. Mm-hmm. And
Refuse to Lose.
Yeah, his program in the movie was called Refuse to Lose. And we even made little coffee cups with all the nine steps on them. And
I gotta start searching eBay for this.
Yes.
His opening line is, there are two kinds of people in the world.
Winners and losers.
That's really how he sees the world.
So, you know, when you talk about not achieving your dream, our culture is so built on the idea of chasing your dream.
Yeah.
And which, you know, you have to have a vision for what you want to get a fighting chance to get something. But then this is about what happens when those dreams don't come true and what's left, you know, what do you have?
And he says to Olive, do you really think you can win the Little Miss Sunshine pageant, because there's no reason to compete unless you can win, which is a terrible thing for a father to say to a child.
No, exactly.
And she feels the pressure and says yes, because she really wants to do it. And he's like, all right, let's do it. The family starts tearing at the seams because of this perfectionism, because we're not focused on being your best. We're focused on being the best.
As if that's even an achievable goal.
This episode is sponsored by PDS Debt.
PDS Debt rolls all of your payments into one low monthly payment.
Maybe PDS Debt could have helped Richard get back on his feet when he didn't land that big whale of an investor.
PDS Debt would have really helped me when I was fresh out of graduate school, or even up to 10 years after graduate school, when I still had student loan debts and mounting bills when I was starting a family and then starting a business, and it just felt really overwhelming to navigate it all.
Also could have helped me, don't know if you were aware, I went into a significant amount of debt to finance CTU Provo. The budget was higher than the reported budget, and it all came out of debt from me.
Oh my gosh. PDS Debt has customized options for anyone struggling with credit cards, personal loans, collections, or medical bills.
You can save thousands on interest and fees, pay off your debt in less time. It's a good deal.
Anyone with $10,000 or more in eligible debt qualifies, and there is no minimum credit score required.
I've never not had $10,000 worth of debt. PDS Debt is offering a free debt analysis. It only takes 30 seconds.
Head over to pdsdebt.com/cinema to get your free debt assessment today.
It's okay to be skinny, and it's okay to be fat if that's what you want to be. Whatever you want, it's okay.
Okay, but Olive, let me ask you this. Those women in Miss America, are they skinny or fat?
No.
Honey?
Well, they're skinny, I guess.
Yeah, guess they don't eat a lot of ice cream.
Those waffles are gonna be awful lonely in there. Mm.
Watch this.
Wait, stop, eat it all.
Good.
All right, Olive.
Richard.
I look at around this table and I look at Alan Arkin's character, and at this point he's just like kind of over it. Like, how much energy am I going to put into these people, because they're kind of ridiculous, right? And then you have Steve Carell's character Frank, who was the world's number one Proust scholar and was in a relationship with a very attractive younger man.
He lost it all.
And then you have Tony Collette's character, who's just like, this is not the family life I had envisioned for myself or hoped for. And you can see that on her face. And then Dwayne, Paul Dano's character, he's a teenager. And these people, except for his little sister and his mom, and, well, actually just his dad. He likes everybody else. But Richard is kind of reacting to what he sees as a ragtag team of losers that need his leadership if they would just accept it.
Exactly.
And what they're saying is, no, you're a blowhard who comes on way too strong, because you're not listening. A lot of the most harmful parenting comes from a place of love. I think he loves his family.
Yeah. But he does.
He doesn't know how.
He has this program that he wants to prove works, and he's going to prove it with his own family.
Yeah.
And I think it's that rigidness, and it's that sticking to these concepts. They're immovable objects, and life doesn't work that way. So yeah. he's discovering slowly and painfully that everything he's believed in is not going to save him.
Okay, I can come by. I'm going to be coming through there. I could swing right by.
His business deal is coming down.
He's not getting it.
Yeah. So just that moment of realization from Alan Arkin, you get to see some pain from Edwin where he's like, oh no, I actually care about my son and this hurts. And then this beautiful scene.
Yeah.
Whatever happens, you try to do something on your own, which is more than most people ever do. And I include myself in that category. You took a big chance, and it took guts, and I'm proud of you.
Okay, Dad, thank you.
But then he finally lets it in.
And the way Kinnear plays that, it's just all in his face.
It is so beautiful to see these exchanges and the softening. And, and then, of course, all that's being filmed on a live freeway traveling at 60 miles an hour. So it's like to be able to act and maintain under these crazy conditions.
I haven't seen that since Alan. We haven't watched it since Alan died. And it's really hard to see that because he's such an amazing actor. And the fact that he's so funny and then he can bring that kind of create that moment.
And his character is displaying for his son what he was already displaying for Olive, which is you don't have to be the best. You just have to do your best.
Yeah.
I like to tell people when they're stressed about their efforts, if their efforts are going to be enough, I say, look, let's be practical. All you can do is all you can do.
Right.
And that's all you can do. Like, there is no shame in doing your absolute best and then letting the chips fall where they are. Right. And that's what he's trying to teach his son, because he sees his son as so stressed out. And of course, and this is why I don't hate Richard. His family is on the ropes financially. They don't know how they're going to get by. They don't know if they're going to keep their home, how they're going to keep food on the table. And now they're doing this road trip for his daughter, which everybody is on board with because they love her. But he's just sitting here thinking, how are we going to make ends meet? And his dad is telling him, look, you're going to figure it out. But first of all, don't stew in this like it's an abject failure and like you're a loser. It's not about nailing the 9 steps and guaranteeing an outcome.
Yeah.
It's about being decent. And he shows his son decency. And I think a seed is planted in this scene that we don't see grow and sprout until the end of the film when Richard stops being an asshole.
Until this point, the adult characters have tolerated each other or sniped at each other, or the only tenderness we've seen is directed towards Olive.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And here we get a break from that. Yeah, the performance is so good from Arkin and from Greg Kinnear. It's just incredible.
Yeah. Helping her practice her dance routine.
World champion growler. Time for your beauty rest. Get in there.
How long were you guys growling straight into lenses?
You didn't want to stop. Yeah. Say that.
Yeah.
Good night.
So beautiful.
It's so much fun.
Yeah.
I'm kind of scared about tomorrow.
Are you kidding me? You're going to blow them out of the water. They're not going to know what hit them.
Grandpa?
Yeah.
Am I pretty?
Olive? You are the most beautiful girl in the whole world.
You're just saying that?
No, I'm not. I'm madly in love with you. And it's not because of your brains or your personality. It's because you're beautiful. Inside and out.
Grandpa?
What?
I don't want to be a loser.
You're not a loser. Where'd you get the idea you're a loser?
Because Dad hates hates losers.
Whoa. Back up a minute. You know what a loser is? A real loser is somebody that's so afraid of not winning, they don't even try. Now, you're trying, right?
Yeah.
Well, then you're not a loser. We're going to have fun tomorrow, right?
I wish I had, like, more pithy commentary right now, but Abigail is just breaking my heart.
Tell them all to go to hell. Good night.
Tell them all to go to hell.
I love you.
I've modeled most of my parenting on Alan Arkin in this film. I don't know how that's going to turn out.
Probably pretty well.
Oh, okay, good.
Just hide the magazines if you're really going for that.
I don't.
This is really on the nose dialogue. This is where you're saying, here's the message of the film, and we've got a lot of subtlety in this movie, but this scene isn't it. This is what the point of what we're trying to get across.
You're pinpointing something
that it was most difficult scene for Alan, and he wanted to rewrite it, and we tried all kinds of rewrites kind of as we were shooting, and mm-hmm. and he even tried some improv stuff, and the scene wasn't working because he was just sitting on the bed with her and basically saying what you're talking about. It was just
the Full House moment on the bed. Yeah,
it was Full House. And so we were like, this isn't working. What are we going to do? She's amazing, he's amazing, but it's not working. What he really needed to be doing was going into the bathroom to get his heroin. Just changing his action. So this is kind of a director thing, but by just telling him, your goal is to get into that bathroom and snort heroin.
Yep.
But you have to deal with this problem. So it gave the scene attention, because you can see in the scene, he keeps trying to get up and go to the bathroom. So, and just that action for him helped him play the scene better. So he wasn't just pouring all this love on her.
Well, just the irony that he's trying to get to this place that's going to end up with his death. But it was just what we needed.
Where's your grandpa right now?
In the trunk of our car.
He's putting her before the drugs that he really, really wants to fix. But what he wants even more than that is to comfort this sweet little angel that he adores so much.
Right.
It speaks to the duality of that character, you know? He's kind of a cranky, dirty old man, but he's also an absolute sweetheart.
Yep.
Really beautiful piece of acting.
It was Alan. You know, Alan is forever this great person who brings all of his integrity to his films. And it was just, you know, everyone on this show was among our favorite people. They still are in our lives, and
And I just feel, for whatever reason, the need to say he's fantastic in The Rocketeer.
How do I look?
Like a hood ornament.
He really is.
Oh, yeah.
He's so good in that movie.
He's a Tucci. He elevates everything he's in.
Wait, it's all right. Hold on. The emergency is
okay. So Dwayne's just learned that he's not going to be able to fly, which is his dream and what his vow of silence is about, because he's colorblind and he's not going to be able to be, is it the Air Force or Navy pilot?
He wants to fly fighter jets. Air Force.
This better be good. I'm calling over. All right. Stop the car. Okay.
So how much time did you spend with the mixers and sound designers perfecting the horn? Because it is the funniest sound effect maybe in movie history.
Yeah.
Every horn was carefully placed.
What happened?
He's colorblind. He can't fly.
Jesus, no.
Okay, I don't want to be your family. I hate you people. I hate you! Divorce? Bankrupt? Suicide? You f***ing losers! You losers!
Oh, man. It's heartbreaking and hilarious at the same time.
I know.
Okay, please.
It's getting late. Maybe can somebody stay here with them?
I'll stay.
That is not happening.
We're all going to go be there for Olive. I love her cowboy boots. So
I know that outfit.
Just worried about the time.
Yeah,
Olive.
He's so weaselly.
He is the ticking clock, literally.
Yep.
Yes, Olive. Do you want to go talking to him? She's like, she's just a kid. Don't put that on her. And she's like, sure.
Yeah.
Olive is completely without guile. She's like, yeah, I'll go help him. This is such a beautiful moment.
Your head. That's what does it.
Oh, man.
What I think is so beautiful about this scene, it, from like a family dynamics level, mom is trying to manage all the things as mom's, it falls on them unjustly, right? But that everything falls on them. So she's like, she's trying to balance. I've got a son whose dreams were just crushed. I've got a daughter whose dreams will be crushed if we don't get moving. And she's trying to resolve that with words. Look, I'm really sorry. And I hate that we have to get moving, but we have to get moving. And at this point, he's like, screw it. I don't care about you guys or your needs. Like, I'm just devastated, and you guys haven't been especially supportive. And I love that Olive comes down and literally just holds him.
Yeah.
And honestly, I know it feels like when you're watching this that it's the power and the innocence of a child that does it. I honestly think had mom come down
and done
the exact same thing, it would have had the same result.
Yeah.
Because mm-hmm. he just needed compassion. He just right. needed people to say, this is terrible and I'm sorry, and to show it with their actions.
Yeah.
And something that I get a lot as a therapist is people asking me, what do I say? Right? Here's my situation. What do I say? If you're worried about what to say, you're probably thinking too much.
Yeah.
Less words are better and more actions. And mm-hmm. oftentimes a person just needs to be held. And Olive shows him, you just lost your dream. You're still enough. Like, to me, you're my big brother.
Yeah.
Right.
It's so powerful. Richard is starting to witness. He thought what would heal his family was the 9 steps. And it's actually what was going to heal his family is if they stop being dicks to each other.
Right.
And start just being kind and compassionate. And his dad models it, and now Olive models it, and the family's on their way to healing.
Total side note. Just 3 years prior to this, I found out that I was not going to be able to fly jets in the Air Force, which was my lifelong dream.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
From the time I was a little kid, my dad was in the Air Force. All I wanted to do was fly fighter jets. And I found out when I was 21 that I wasn't going to be able to. And this scene tore me in half.
Like, oh my God.
I had a full blown panic attack. People were like looking at me like, I pulled in. Like,
oh, I think that's what we loved about this material is I felt like there were so many ways in for people.
Yes.
And it was the most rewarding thing, you know, we'll ever probably experience in our work, that you see, you get to be with the people experiencing your film.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
it's therapeutic, I would, you know.
It is. It is.
Say. Yeah.
We agree.
Hey, how are you feeling?
Better. Where's Olive?
Here, what's up?
Mom, I don't want Olive doing this.
Oh my God!
Look around. Oh, this place is great. I don't want these people judging Olive. Them.
Listen, it is too late.
No, it's not too late. You're the mom, and you're supposed to protect her. Everyone is gonna laugh at her, Mom. Please don't let her do this.
Olive Hoover, 2 minutes.
Look, she's not a beauty queen. She's just not. I'm gonna tell her.
No, no, Dwayne, you listen to me. Olive is who she is. She has worked so hard. She's poured everything into this. We can't just take it away from her. We can't. I know you want to protect her. I know, honey, but I'm gonna let Olive be Olive.
Olive Hoover, are you the family?
Yeah.
Okay. Chloe from 24. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's time.
Marilyn Rashku.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We gotta go now.
Yeah, hang on. Olive, look at me. If you don't want to do this, that's okay. If you want to sit this one out, it's totally fine by us. We're proud of you anyway.
We gotta go. It's time.
Doing the same job here she did in 24, being the ticking clock.
Yeah.
Ready?
She's really good at it.
Yeah.
She's the best.
Richard's resigned, like, ugh.
Yeah.
It's just such a great button on that scene. I love it.
Well, and what's so powerful, I love, one, that mom makes it all his choice and doesn't pressure her, just says, you have the options.
Yeah.
Because dad and brother are like, let's just get out of here. They're gonna tear her to shreds. And they're right. She gets up on stage and people laugh, or people are shocked and appalled. But what is so beautiful about this film's now infamous climax is that the family recognizes all we really need is to accept one another for who we are and support and sustain each other for who we are. So when everyone gets up on stage, and so Olive's not alone doing her quite provocative dance routine because that nobody knew was coming because Grandpa taught it to her. Like she's crawling.
Oh my gosh. Oh, so good.
Yeah.
This is a artistic representation of family therapy, right? That we go from perfectionism to acceptance and support and love. That we go from, okay, everything's riding on these dreams to, well, if we don't have these dreams, like, we still have each other.
Right.
And it's really powerful when they get to this place after bickering and sniping and all the hurt and all the pent-up rage and frustration, and they come to this place of forgiveness and unity. And what I really like about it is afterwards, Frank is still going to think that Richard's an ass, but just a little bit less.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You know? And
Richard does prove his love extends to the greatest degree. And, you know, I think what's important in that scene is that Olive's going to go do this because she wants to do it and she loves to dance. And her dancing and the joy that she has there on stage, the family realizes this is what we're here to support. And then this is what we're here to protect. And that's why they jump on stage.
Protect her.
Is that they now see there's this thing, this pure pleasure and something that Olive loves.
And I think the other thing is what's great is that they lose, but
spectacularly.
Win.
Yeah.
But you can lose and still win. You know, I think there's something interesting about that. And because if you just had the audience loving it, because you know, all the you know, you that's a possible
Rocky IV, the Russians are now chanting for Rocky. This crowd is now turned. They're now team.
Yeah.
They're now team Olive. Yeah.
You just needed one guy to be won over. So the biker at the end.
Yeah. But like the fact that everyone is shocked and appalled and the family at that point is saying, that's okay. Like, we're not doing this for you is lovely. Yeah. And I think that whatever we suffer empowers us to be more compassionate for other people if we let it. And that's something to Richard's credit. When he loses and he bets the farm and loses big, it's a major paradigm shift for him that he realizes, you know, looking at his family, it's not about winning. It's about us, you know, and that is, it's such a beautiful film. And what it really threads the needle on is being such a beautiful film without being saccharine. And that's why our rating is so important.
It really is. We bleeped the swears for this because of monetization. Thanks, YouTube. They're used incredibly well. And without it, it would be too sticky sweet.
A lot of women, kid. I have no reason to lie to you.
No, it's the way these people talk, and it's honest, and, you know.
It's always, you know, the only time I swear is when I'm feeling something, you know, bigger than other ways of expressing it don't, you know.
Yeah,
right.
And we had to fight to keep the swearing in. There was actually a discussion.
Oh, I'm sure lots of people were like, hey, let's go for the PG-13. Let's get rid of that stuff.
Yeah. And to take the drugs out,
Yep.
Yeah. We won in that way.
Yes.
We were winners.
We all won.
We all won.
Yeah, we all won.
And you guys won in a lot of ways. You created a timeless classic.
It's been a gift to our lives, I have to say. Yeah. That's the great thing about filmmaking is that you get to keep it. You know, you do it, you work really hard, and then there's this thing that lives forever.
Yeah.
We enjoyed making it so much, and that the end result wasn't really the goal. You know, it was just making it the best we could make it, and then luckily it reached an audience, you know.
It was the right film at the right time.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll be watching.
So until next time.
Sarcasm is the refuge of losers.
It is, really?
And
watch movies.
We want to thank our patrons for supporting this show and getting a lot of cool behind-the-scenes content. People like
Xavier Stewart.
Lisa C.
Katie Klein.
Sarah Perkins, all lowercase.
And Julie Elder.
Thanks, everyone. Especially lowercase people. You're just as big to us as uppercase people.
We don't see size, actually.